Well, and I was glad you explained also that the Buddha didn't write down his teachings. This was either oral history translation, or eventually it got written down.
Yes.
Yeah.
I read somewhere that the monks congregated after his passing, and there were these different groups of monks who were assigned different suttas to learn and recite and study. And periodically they would come together to make sure nobody is practicing the wrong version. And if there are any things that anything that was mismatched, they would. That went on for several 100 years before it was written down.
Oh, interesting. Even more interesting then. So they were collectively making sure of the purity of the form of the teaching.
Yeah, before really like written devices were even available. The interest, so there's many suttas, and I think there's these collections of suttas. I think there are four collections. They are considered the early Buddhist texts.
Pali Canon,
The, um, yeah, and then there's a few more that probably have been kind of stories or teachings that could have happened, but probably not verbatim taught by the Buddha, but kind of in his spirit, a teaching. Why do people know, or like, why do scholars know that these four collections of discourses are authentic? So they've basically what Sophia said. So the history is like, so it was all oral
Transmission.
transmission, and then it got translated, and then there were people moved, people had to move, people migrated out of choice or out of force. Monks migrated, and of course the teachings spread because they're good teachings, just like that. And so the teachings spread like into China and into Burma and to Thailand and to Sri Lanka and other parts of what is that, Southeast Asia, kind of
South and South
South and
Asia.
Southeast Asia, Japan also, of course. And nowadays, scholars look at these different translations and see they have different canons because of these different branches of Buddhism. But there is a certain amount of overlap that is, if you translate them all together, they are amazingly identical, like so. It's mind-blowingly identical that after 2,500 years and so many translations and migrations and no written, early on, no written transmission, they can be so much the same. And so because of those studies done by scientists, scientific scholars, as well as monastic scholars, they basically have a good idea. I mean, you never know for sure, of course. But they have a good idea what texts are very likely to be authentic teachings and which ones are not. And most what is in these four Nikayas, in these four collections, among which is the Majjhima Nikaya, that middle length sayings that we read from today, most of those are considered authentic, and there's three other Nikayas, three other collections that are where they say there's probably 80, 90 to maybe even 100% authenticity in those books. Basically, what they're saying is when you read a sutta and there's a teaching where the Buddha says apparently something very specific, like, I don't know, one sutta may say you have to meditate in this posture, or like you cannot meditate while sitting next to a stream. I'm making things up now, okay? So he says something very particular, and that could be very specific to a certain, because he talked to a certain person or a small group of people, but maybe completely out of context. And so the recommendation of those scholars is to take basically the, like, you got to know a good number of suttas and take the spirit of those, the teacher, kind of the messages in them, and read other suttas in that light. So if there's something that's really kind of outlandish in one particular sutta, then don't think like, oh, this is the solution, and just go with that. Some teachers do that. There's teachers out there who kind of have one particular sutta and then they teach that and only that and say, this is the only right way of doing things. And those scholars recommend basically the opposite. They say like, if there is one teaching that's kind of not fits into all the other teachings, it's most likely not authentic. It has most likely been added on later by someone, just like the Bible was written and basically is commentary about what's going on. And there's many coherent things, but a few outliers are there there too. And so you gotta understand the context, because these teachings, again, there could be an error in transmission, there could be an later addition, or there could simply be the context of that particular teachings was so specific that it cannot be generalized. So that's basically the how we know what, or how we think we know is authentic and what isn't.
Oh, thank you. That's a marvelous explanation. So you have scholars that are looking at what is generally accepted as the character of the Buddha or the character of the sutta. And if something seems out of character, it's put aside and not mainstreamed as the teachings.
Yeah, it may be, keep it maybe in the back of the mind, maybe it's applicable to some certain situation, but maybe weigh it a little lesser in general. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that. Yeah. Thank you.
There's, I think the, you, Brahmali, you want to? Yeah. Okay. You go ahead.
Yeah. There is actually a study done by Ajahn Brahmali, also one of the monks from Australia, who studied the various translations of the Buddha's teachings and came to, he's written a book called, Christoph, you know?
These are the authors, Ajahn Brahmali and Pante Sujato.
I think it's called Authentic something, Texts of the Buddha.
I think it's something about the authenticity text of the early Buddhist text,
yes,
or something.
Yes, we can send you a link if that's of interest.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And thank you. Yeah.